Committee will come to order. We do have a quorum. We do have four items on today's agenda. To try to be as efficient and respectful as everyone's time, what I would like to do today is I will call upon each bill's sponsor to come up and explain their legislation. And when all of the bills are explained to the committee and to the public, we'll then get into the witness list. This is just to avoid folks having to come up here three and four times, because I'm guessing that most folks that are going to be testifying will probably want to testify on each bill. So we will start with Senate Bill 2246, introduced by Majority Leader Ruggiero, an act relating to state affairs and government, Rhode Island Bridge Replacement, Reconstruction, and Maintenance Fund tolls. Leader Ruggiero.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Those of you that were here last year, probably with the exception of Senator Pagliarini, recall that we passed a piece of legislation similar to the one that you're looking at, and that had to do with the tolls. There are some changes in the legislation, as probably everyone in this room knows, and I'll go over them quickly, and then I'll allow the director to say what he has to say regarding the legislation. Last year's bill compared to this year's bill, we have three fewer tolling facilities that we had last year. Last year, if you recall, there were 17 proposed. Now it's down to 14. The typical toll fee is estimated at $3. The maximum I-95 through the state truck toll will be $20. That's going from probably one end of the state to the other end. The 610 connector, as we call it, will be fully funded under this program. And the toll bond, if you recall, was at $600 million at one time, and those were revenue bonds, and now it's at $300 million, and those are Agave bonds, which are bonds that were borrowed in anticipation of the federal money that we'll be getting. Also, obviously, that figure is cut in half as far as bonding purposes, and I feel that's probably the best thing that's come out of this piece. And we were able to do that, obviously, with the addition of $102 million of federal money over 5 years, in addition to what we're currently receiving. And the total interest cost on that as a result of the reduction of the bonds is probably about 66%, and that goes from $189 million to previously what was $548 million. So those are the essential changes to the legislation that was passed last year, and at this point in time, I'm willing to entertain any questions that the committee might have.
Thank you very much. Any questions from the committee for Leader Ruggiero?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee.
Thank you. The next we will take up is Senate Resolution Number 2247, introduced by Senator Pagliarini, joint resolution to approve and publish and submit to the electors a proposition of amendment to the Constitution, restriction on tolling. Senator Pagliarini.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. 2247 is a standalone resolution, and what its intent is to authorize by a constitutional amendment that there'll be no tolls on passenger vehicles in the state of Rhode Island without a referendum vote of the people. The 2246 has similar language in it, a referendum. However, 2246 is subject to the will and the want of the General Assembly on each and any year. 2247 is a constitutional amendment, which is a higher standard of protection for the voters and residents of the state of Rhode Island. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator. Any questions from the committee for Senator Pagliarini? Hearing none. Now that you're standing there,
that's what I think.
We will go to Senate Resolution Number 2248, introduced by yourself, a joint resolution to approve and publish and submit to the electors a proposition of amendment to the Constitution, restriction on tolling.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. 2248 prohibits tolling of any type, passenger vehicle or trucks, without a constitutional referendum by constitutional amendment. So the difference between 2247 and 2248 is that it also includes no tolling of trucks without a vote of the people of the state of Rhode Island. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions or comments from the committee? Hearing none. And the fourth and final item on today's agenda, Senate Resolution 2153 by Senator Raptakis, a joint resolution creating a special legislative commission to study and review all aspects of future tolling of motor vehicles. Senator Raptakis, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What my bill does, it creates a study commission, 13-member joint Senate and House study commission. And what the bill does, it's a timeout. All the study commission does is calls for 90 days, expires on May 2nd, to put together a study commission by both the House and Senate members, members of the public, members of DOT, members of the administration, to look at this very closely. This is a 10-year project, and all I'm asking is for 90 days. We've been bombarded by pros and cons on this project. What's right, what's wrong, studies from experts. But I think really that this General Assembly should call timeout, 90 days, study it very closely. I have a binder here, 400 pages of this roadworks project. I haven't even started to look at it. 400 pages of what this project's all about. There's questions about how do we resolve the issue without going into bonding. You know, now we have a new bonding process of $300 million. We're going to pay interest of $204 million. Well, why can't we, for example, why can't we add 2 cents to the gas tax and collect the difference of $94 million and not bother borrowing $300 million and paying back $204 million? That's just an example, Mr. Chairman. And I think this is the right way to do it. Call a timeout. Let's put a study commission, both the House and Senate. Bring all the stakeholders in. 90 days is not a huge delay. When we're talking a 10-year project. And get everyone together, the public. Let's hear testimony over the course of the next 90 days. Come to a decision on May 2nd. It puts something together that's going to make sense for all Rhode Islanders and for all taxpayers. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator Raptakis. Any questions or comments for Senator Raptakis? Senator Palmer.
Senator Raptakis, just one question. I assume you meant 20 cents on the gas tax to get $90 million? Because otherwise...
So you get... No. On every penny, it's $4.3 million.
Right. You said $96 million.
What I'm saying is we're looking at this new proposal that we're going to borrow $300 million. We're going to pay back an additional $204 million in interest. So now it's $504 million. If we already know that we have the $204 million put aside to pay back the interest, in my mathematical equation, it's 300 minus 204. It's a balance of 96 million. So over the course of 10 years, we can't find 9.6 million every year in this budget. Instead of, you know, we hear that people want to make some substantial cuts in the budget, but at 9.6 million, 2 cents in the gasoline tax, it raises 4.3 million for every penny. There's your close to $9.6 million, give or take a couple hundred thousand dollars. So we don't have to go out and borrow $300 million in Garvey bonds. We know we have the 204, like I said earlier, set aside to pay the interest. All we need is $9.6 million for the next 10 years every year.
Thank you, Chairman. I just want to make sure it wasn't 1 year. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Hearing none, thank you. We will go to the witness list. We do have... everyone that has signed up on each of the bills will all be heard. We're going to start with Peter Alviti, Director of the Rhode Island Department of Transportation.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and members of the committee for allowing me to present our revised roadworks program updated to reflect the very positive impacts of the federal Fixing America's Surface Transportation, or FAST Act, that Congress recently passed into law. Much has happened since the last time I was with you 6 months ago, over 6 months ago. Over the summer, we completed an enhanced inspection of all of our state's structurally deficient bridges, providing us with an up-to-date understanding of our infrastructure condition. We completed and released a level two analysis of our traffic counts, which confirmed our original estimates. We completed and released an economic impact analysis of the roadworks proposal, which demonstrates the program would create over 6,000 jobs, expand gross state product, and actually attract more people to move into Rhode Island. We produced the first in the state and only third in the nation 10-year transportation planning document and submitted it to the State Planning Council for their review and consideration. And we have begun a monumental transformation of the Rhode Island Department of Transportation organization, management, procurement, and project delivery. But while much has changed, some things remain the same. We still have one out of every five bridges rated structurally deficient. We still have the worst bridges in America. As a native Rhode Islander and a civil engineer, it pains me to tell you this. It pains me that the state that I was born in, raised my family in, and received my education has not been able to address something so fundamental to our economic well-being and prosperity as properly maintaining our roads and bridges. Since June, 14 bridges have been removed from the structurally deficient list thanks to repairs or removal of the bridge that we've worked on. Unfortunately, during that same period, 14 additional bridges became structurally deficient. This demonstrates the nature of the challenge we face. It's not enough to simply fix the bridges that are structurally deficient today. We must implement a plan that addresses both the bridges that are structurally deficient today and invest in preventive measures to prevent new bridges from becoming structurally deficient. It's only by taking this approach that we'll arrest the state's history of infrastructure decline and move towards a state of good repair. Rhode Island ranks last in the nation at 23% structurally deficient bridges, 50th out of 50 states in the percent of structurally deficient bridges, and 42% of our bridges are over 50 years old. Of the 1,162 bridges in Rhode Island, about 22% of them, one out of every five, are still structurally deficient. There were other important changes in our infrastructure condition since we last met. The Route 610 interchange continued its decay. The replacement project for 610 has been in design and unfunded for over 30 years. The contract for the design of Route 6 and 10 was awarded 30 years ago, and it's currently at 30% completion. In that time, we've braced this failing infrastructure in order to keep it open. Sadly, some of the very braces are now in need of repair. Months ago, we determined that we need to award another interim repair project just to keep the structure safe. That contract cost will be funded from our emergency repair program. And it's yet another example of this cost to the taxpayers of failing to properly maintain our infrastructure. That's some millions of dollars of improvements that we make will essentially be thrown away once the new infrastructure is built. We need to address Route 6 and 10, and we need to address it now. The increasing costs of 610 are not the only area of concern that prompted us to act with urgency. As you can see in this chart, the cost of bridge repairs increases exponentially over time. Could you go back to slide 7, please? Once you get past a certain point in the curve, the increasing rate of increase means that projects that today we could accomplish simply as a preservation effort, if deferred to tomorrow, could very quickly require a much more costly construction effort. In fact, $950 million is being saved, or will be saved, by implementing this asset management approach. Every one of our 1,165 bridges has a curve like this, and they're at various points in their age. As part of the development of our 10-year plan, our engineers carefully plotted, bridge by bridge, the cost of delaying the infrastructure program. The end result is that if we act now, we can save taxpayers nearly $1 billion in reconstruction costs by funding bridge reconstruction and preservation projects now. Changing the oil is far less expensive than changing the engine. That's why it's so important we advance with roadworks program now. And that reconstruction effort can be much more costly. A preservation project that records show would cost $157 per square foot of bridge deck can quickly triple or even quadruple if rehabilitation or full replacement is required. When I arrived at DOT in February, the plan that I was presented indicated that at current funding levels or at historical funding levels to the department, even with the additional funding provided by Article 21, the best Rhode Island could do, or the best we could achieve, would be to manage the decline of our bridges. The state would slip from today's 1 out of every 5 bridges being structurally deficient to 1 out of every 2, or half of our bridges, in very short order. This is unacceptable to me. That's why we quickly put in place a team of engineers, finance people, and planners to develop a plan to address our infrastructure. We moved to a cash flow management organization, improved contract packaging, and prioritized bridges, both in terms of fixing those that are already structurally deficient and funding preservation of those on the cusp of reaching a dire state. The result is the roadworks program. This program will allow us to reach the federal minimum standard of 90% structural sufficiency by 2025. The program includes reconstruction of more than 150 structurally deficient bridges and repairs more than 500 other bridges. Roadworks accomplishes these repairs by funding a surge of funding and projects, increasing the total program size by 30%, and investing over $1 billion more in our infrastructure when including anticipated new federal discretionary funding. This upfront surge will not only provide us the funding to achieve 90% sufficiency by 2025, it also provides us with the local funding we need upfront to attract competitive federal discretionary funding and finally begin construction of the 610 reconstruction effort. Having a good plan is one thing, funding it is another. That's why, in addition to developing a detailed plan of action of bridges and pavement projects to implement over the next 10 years, we also developed a funding plan to support the incremental cost of the surge of infrastructure investment needed to fix the state's bridges and other issues once and for all. The roadworks funding program includes a combination of new user fees on tractor trailers, borrowing and pay-go federal funding to support the infrastructure renewal program. The version of roadworks you are considering this week is different from the one you considered last June. The differences are driven by the additional federal funding we will receive as a result of the FAST Act, the federal transportation bill enacted late last year. The FAST Act will provide Rhode Island with an annual increase of federal highway funding of nearly 3.5% over the next 5 years. This may not seem like much, but our previous plan assumed no increase over current funding levels to be conservative. This higher funding stream allows us to reduce the number of gantries from 17 to 14 and lower the cap on tolls from $30 to $20. It also changes the way we finance the improvements from a $600 million toll-backed revenue bond to a $300 million Garvey bond, saving the state $374 million in interest payments, which I'll go into in a little more detail in the next slides. A very important similarity, however, to the last bill is that it only authorizes tollings of Class 8 and above trucks, tractor trailers and lodgers. And in this version of the bill, tolling of passenger vehicles, that's motorcycles, cars, SUVs, vans, and pickups, would require a statewide referendum of the people. We want to be very clear here. We have no intention of tolling cars, not now, not ever. The old and the new plans also have a different funding profile in the first 4-5 years. On the left of this slide, you can see the previous version relied on a $600 million toll back revenue bond and $120 million from a Garvey refinance for a total of $720 million funding in the first 5 years. We have the same $120 million from the Garvey refinance and $300 million new money from a Garvey finance. We also expect $40 million in FAST Act funds to be available after Garvey debt service. We also anticipate collecting about $120 million in toll revenue in the first 5 years. This results in a total of $580 million in the first 5 years, which is $140 million less than the previous plan. You may ask, why don't I see any toll revenue shown on the left-hand side? The reason is that all of the toll revenue was used to pay back the toll-back revenue bond in economic incentives. While a 5-year funding is less in the new roadworks plan, it actually results in more money. It's less in the first 5 years. It actually results in more money over the full 10-year plan period. The pie chart on the left is the same one on the previous page again. That's because the funding came from toll-back revenue bond and Garvey refinance, with the tolls all going to pay debt service and cover other costs. On the right, you see the 10-year breakdown of the new roadworks plan. In addition to $300 million of Garvey bond and $120 million of Garvey refinance, we expect to bring in about $350 million in toll revenue, $80 million in FAST Act funding after Garvey debt service, and this leads to a total of roughly $850 million or $130 million more than the original roadworks plan. An important note is that we're also going to apply for $400 million in federal funding to help pay for the Route 610, particularly the transit portion of that. This is through competitive federal discretionary programs, and I'll touch more on that a little bit later. Assuming we receive the federal grants, the total new roadworks program would be an additional $1.2 billion over historical funding levels during the next 10 years. Now getting into the tolling implementation. We propose only tolling Class 8 and above trucks. The chart at the right shows the Federal Highway Vehicle Classification System. As you can see, we have no intent to toll, and the legislation specifically prohibits tolls on cars, trucks, vans, buses, RVs, and single-unit trucks. Class 8 trucks are the first class of vehicle to have a separate tractor and trailer. This is important not only because they're bigger and cause more damage to our roads, but also because the two-unit trucks are easier for all electronic tolling systems to identify. You may ask, why are we only proposing to toll Class 8 and above trucks? Well, a fully loaded tractor trailer causes 9,600 times the damage of a passenger car on our roads. As you can see from the chart, Class 8 and above cause a higher percentage of damage, almost 70% of the damage. I'm sorry.
Yes.
I'm sorry. 70% of the damage to our roads and bridges, but only contribute about 19% of the funding for the repair of these roadways. So tolling large trucks is a way of appropriately assessing user fees and getting all classes of vehicles to pay their fair share for the use of our roads and bridges. Now, where will we toll? We have proposed placing gantries in 14 locations across the state on our four major highway routes, I-95, I-195, I-295, and Route 146 and Route 6. First, I want to emphasize that these locations are preliminary. We've said this. Second, these are data-driven locations. We identified bridges in need of repair and also took into account the potential diversion in selecting these locations. Third, federal law only allows tolling interstate bridges to fund reconstruction or replacement of bridges. So we'll set up restricted receipt accounts for each tolling location and use the funding to fix those bridges being tolled. The federal government will audit us each year on the use of that tolling revenue, and the U.S. Secretary of Transportation can suspend tolling if this funding is not being used appropriately. So how will we make sure the tolls don't slow down traffic? Well, we plan to use an all-electronic tolling system. There'll be no toll booths, only overhead gantries with highly sophisticated sensing equipment. The equipment will only pick up radio frequency identifiers such as EasyPass, but also can distinguish between tractor trailers and regular cars or even single unit trucks. There'll be no need to stop or even slow down when going under the tolling gantries, and for most people, everyone not driving tractor trailers, the gantries will have no impact whatsoever. Rhode Island will be well within the norm of the Northeast states on tolling. We will not be an outlier on this issue. Contrary to the scare tactics of the bill's opponents, these modest tolls will not make Rhode Island uncompetitive. Our proposed tolls are only 46 cents per mile. That's less than half the toll per mile in Maryland, New Jersey, New York, and Delaware. In New York alone, large trucks pay $126 just to cross the George Washington Bridge. These tolls are seen by trucking companies as a cost of doing business in numerous other states, and it will be just the same here in Rhode Island. Another important misconception that I've heard about this bill, as I've met with citizens and elected officials across the state, is the toll amount. We're proposing a maximum toll of $20 to cross the entire state on I-95, and a total of $40 tolled per day, no matter how many or how much a truck drives around the state. That translates into a typical toll of only $3 per gantry. And the highest toll we anticipate would be about $5.50. Just as with the locations, the toll amounts would be set in a data-driven way. We will look at the needs of the bridge or groups of bridges being tolled, how much the reconstruction would cost, and how much large trucks are currently contributing. Based on those factors, we'll determine a fair toll amount that is consistent with Federal Highway Administration guidance for setting tolls. The proposed amounts will also be subject to a public comment ahead of implementation. This is mandated in the bill that we're proposing, and we fully support that. Diversion is an area where tolling opponents will use scare tactics, saying they'll drive their tractor trailers through residential neighborhoods. We know this will not be the case for two reasons. First, we'll work with the State Traffic Commission to restrict likely diversion routes to local traffic only, meaning no through trucks can drive on local and residential streets. This is allowed by existing state law. Second, we know that truckers see tolls as just another cost of doing business, and the cost of time and money are far more important than a modest toll. When the Pawtucket, for example, when the Pawtucket River Bridge was weight restricted several years ago, trucks regularly paid a $3,000 fine to cross it rather than take a longer detour. $3,000. It's totally unrealistic to expect trucks to divert onto slow, indirect roads to avoid a $3 toll when they paid $3,000 to take a direct route across a restricted bridge. I've been meeting with and will continue to meet with mayors and local officials as we move forward on this issue and coordinate our efforts to restrict diversion. With the addition of federal funding under the FAST Act, we no longer need to rely on tolling revenue as the only source of funds to support the surge of bridge investment that we need. By leveraging nearly 3.5% annual increase in federal funding, we can issue a Grant Anticipation Revenue Vehicle, or GAVI bond. GAVI financing is not new to this state. In fact, the original proposal I presented to you last June included a refinancing of our $570 million existing GAVI debt that was authorized by the legislature in 2003. That refinancing would produce a benefit of $120 million in the first 3 years of our program. Now, with the new federal funding, we can issue an additional $300 million in GAVI bonds on top of the refinancing. Again, this is half the size of the $600 million of tollback bonds contemplated in the proposal we originally presented in June. The term of this bond is also shorter, from 30 years to 15 years, and the interest costs are reduced 65%, or $375 million less. Importantly, bonding against our federal revenue only makes sense if we can sustain our ongoing program. The previous 203 Garvey borrowing and its associated other debt for match was nearly $1 billion. Unfortunately, DOT took on that debt with no additional reliable revenue stream to fund its basic program, and after spending that money, we still have the worst bridges in America. The lesson is clear. We can't simply borrow more without a sustainable means of funding our infrastructure over time. We can't simply mortgage the future. That's why the Roadworks proposal includes a combination of bonding along with federal and toll pay-as-you-go funds to produce a reliable and sustainable and dedicated infrastructure funding program, not just for today, but for a decade from now and the decade after that. The Federal FAST Act not only allowed us to shift from tollback bonds to federal-backed bonds, It also makes available billions in federal discretionary funding. This is a competitive funding that allows state DOTs and transportation agencies to access additional federal funding for specific projects, typically a 50-50 matching ratio. You'll recall back in June, the Roadworks program anticipated securing some $400 million for the 610 project by including a transit feature in the project. We contemplated securing this funding through the Federal Transit Administration New Starts program. Our approach to pursuing this funding was simple. If we need to spend $500 million to rebuild the interchange in any case, why not leverage that investment to secure additional federal funding for transit and help improve the state's transit utilization? The bottom line is there's an additional $16 billion of funding available, and Roadworks would put us in a very competitive advantage to gain some of that funding. Fixing the bridges, rebuilding 610, addressing pavement, bikes, and transit, we have much work ahead of us. The good news is that the contractors, the engineering firms, labor, and RIDOT are ready for this work. At RIDOT, we're poised to implement the reorganization you approved as part of the last budget year. This reorganization, arguably the largest in DOT history, will include implementing an asset management approach to our planning and a project management approach to project delivery. Plan your work and work your plan. With this reorganization, we're poised to become only the third state in the union to utilize a 10-year asset management plan and one of less than half the states in the country to use a project management approach in project delivery. Under the project management approach, a project manager is assigned to every project with the responsibility and authority to bring the project in on scope, on schedule, and on budget. I'm pleased to inform you that we will be announcing the hearings for this reorganization next week. We've made many other changes at DOT in preparation for this reorganization. We abolished 40 management and administrative positions, some with titles such as photographer, and turned them into maintenance positions. This represents one of out of every 19 RIDOT employees. We need people filling potholes, not taking pictures of them. We've ended the practice of issuing advance directives to contractors, which allowed them to do work in anticipation of future change orders. And just last week, we issued a procurement for the next task order contractors or consultants, providing a means of accelerating engineering procurements and reducing contract lengths and change orders. With new approaches to planning, project management, accountability, and procurement, we're ready to implement the Roadworks program. The state's construction labor force is ready also. The state's construction labor force is still well underutilized. In the Great Recession, Rhode Island lost over 7,000 construction jobs, and we've only regained less than 10%. Last year, in spite of the RIDOT producing a program over 40% larger than the previous year, construction jobs in Rhode Island still fell slightly. We hear that many construction workers are commuting to Boston to find work. It's time to bring them home. It's time to stop letting Rhode Islanders rebuild Rhode Island's crumbling infrastructure. The good news is that the economic analysis of the Roadworks proposal, the REMI analysis requested by leadership in the legislature, demonstrates the job creation that this program will produce. The REMI economic analysis undertaken by the Department of Administration indicated that the program would create over 6,000 new jobs, increase gross state product by $538 million and actually increase the state's population. The analysis was conducted before the new federal funding was known. So as a result, the benefits of the program can only increase. Importantly, roadworks, the roadworks program is more than simply bridges and pavement. We've developed a 10-year plan that includes those elements plus drainage, traffic safety, transportation alternatives, bike paths, ADA, and transit initiatives. While the funding sources and bond size and composition have changed since our last June proposal, the basic intent and makeup of the program remains the same. The program is before the State Planning Council for their review and public input as we speak. While we're certainly open to dialogue and discussion to improve the prioritization of those projects we're proposing, we remain steadfast in our commitment to fixing the core of the state's infrastructure and bring this state to a state of good repair. While the basic program has remained the same, the benefits of roadworks have changed for the better. With the new federal funding and reduced bonding, we were able to substantially cut interest costs, meaning the net savings after the interest cost by using the asset management approach we're using. We're now projecting the program will save the taxpayers over $700 million in bridge reconstruction costs alone, even after accounting for interest. And we'll still achieve 90% bridge sufficiency by 2025 and have local funding in place to secure additional federal competitive funding and finally rebuild Route 610, all while reducing the through-state toll by a third and reducing the number of tolling locations to 14. When you compare roadworks to those proposals like public-private partnerships and the plans put forth by the truckers and House Bill H-7192, only roadworks plan is large enough to address the challenges we face. And let me take a moment to express my appreciation for these alternate proposals. Everyone who put a proposal together had the same goal in mind, fixing the state's infrastructure. On that, we can all agree. When even the Tea Party proposes spending more money on infrastructure and government, you know we need to do more. As director of DOT, I have a responsibility not simply to the automobile drivers of this state. I also have a responsibility to the transit riders, the cyclists, the pedestrians, and yes, the truckers. Trucking is a vital part of this state's economy. Our roads and highways are the circulatory system of our economy. And in many ways, commercial transportation is a lifeblood. I appreciate all of those who have proposed solutions to the challenges we face, but we have a large problem. We have the worst infrastructure in the country. We need a solution sufficiently sized to address it. The Tea Party plan proposed fixing our bridges with public-private partnership. I'm not a newcomer to public-private partnerships. I did one 20 years ago. I'm a proponent of triple P's. I actually created the first triple P in the state for wastewater when I was DPW director in Cranston over 20 years ago. To be successful, triple P's not only need to harness the best of both the public and private sectors, they also need to have a funding source. To think that private sector will borrow money and fund our bridge needs from their own pockets is simply unrealistic. H-7192 provides less than $3.5 million a year in new funding for transportation and takes that funding from the general fund and the arts. The plan proposed by the Trucking Association provides more new funding than H-7192, but would still generate well less than the amounts needed. Further, it assesses the cost solely against Rhode Island trucking industry. It's simply unfair to fix our roads and bridges on the backs of hardworking Rhode Islanders without getting out-of-state truckers to pay their fair share. At the end of the day, after all the analysis, proposals, and consideration, it's the roadworks proposal that accomplishes the mission and pays for it in a manner that's fair. So where do we go from here? If the roadworks legislation is signed into law, we immediately begin to work on implementation. The very next day after it's signed into law and signed, we have procurements for an owner's rep for the tolling systems bridge reconstruction on one of the I-95 bridges and 610 design environmental work ready to go. With enactment of roadworks, we would immediately begin the final discussions with Federal Highway Administration, who I really have to thank for their support and partnership in helping us through this process. We'll immediately begin discussions on a memorandum of understanding with them and with the federal government, which will finalize the tolling locations. Once we have secured an owner's rep to guide us through the tolling system RFP, we will advertise an RFP and issue a contract for the gantries and back office hardware and software. And I thank the Department of Administration for their help in helping us put that together. This, for example, will be a prime candidate for a triple P, where we have very high technology equipment needing to be put in place on gantries that could result in many different companies contracted separately pointing fingers at each other, as opposed to a single company with a single point of responsibility and risk associated with it. Upon passage, we'll also begin the procurement for a level 3 traffic study such that we can better predict tolling revenue going forward. With respect to financing, we anticipate refinancing our existing Garvey debt and issuing the $300 million of new Garvey debt this spring. And I thank here the Treasurer's Office during the last couple of months working with us and the state's financial advisors working with us. With respect to Route 610, we'll begin working with the congressional delegation immediately to redouble our efforts to secure competitive discretionary funding of 610. And I'd like to thank the congressional delegation for their help in meeting with us during the last several months to discuss this and look forward to working with them going forward. We understand that federal government could be issuing a notice of funding availability as soon as this month. So we'll position the state to secure as much of that funding as we can. And the projects such as 610 fit the needs of applying for those funds very specifically. So we'll stand a good chance at getting a good amount of funding from that. Because we've moved to a cash flow management approach to contract awards at DOT, we can issue $50 million of additional bridge contracts for this season, secure in the knowledge that the funding will be available as invoices come in from those contracts. This represents an increase in our federal fiscal 2016 program size. Finally, with the passage of this legislation, the State Planning Council can finalize the 10-year plan and submit it to the Federal Highway Administration for their approval. In summary, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, RIDOT, our contractors and engineers, and the state's labor community, the congressional delegation, and our partners in federal and state government, we are ready and poised to implement this historic program. I want to thank this committee and this body for the time and attention that you've given this important issue. I appreciate the debate. It's made our proposal stronger. And if approved and signed into law, the taxpayers are the better for the debate and discussion. It's my great hope that no DOT director has to come before you again in the future to deliver the sad report as I did. That this state, once again, has the worst infrastructure in the country. We like to say at DOT, hope is a state motto. It's not a plan. So as a native Rhode Islander, as a civil engineer, I ask that you approve this plan and allow us to bring the many talents of our Rhode Island workforce to bear in fixing our infrastructure. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Director. Just, I guess, one question. This entire analysis has included, obviously, a certain component for diversion. Has any thought gone into, for the Rhode Island-based vehicles that would be subject to a toll, what they potentially might do to possibly downsize to smaller vehicles to try to avoid it, or would that just be cost prohibitive?
Well,
because it would be a, I guess, an indirect form of aversion.
That's certainly a possibility in their business functions, but I wouldn't venture a guess at how many companies would forego the size of the vehicles that they're using for those purposes. But it's certainly a possibility.
And is there, since all of these changes were made since the previous proposal and...
I just might add to that. We're taking into consideration a rather conservative estimate in our financial analysis with regard to diversion. The diversion rate that we're assuming is on the order of 25%. In actuality, we expect that once the traffic controls are in place, that'll be about half that amount. So there's a considerable amount of conservatism in our estimates as we applied the diversion rates to our finance plans.
And is there an estimate, or what is the estimate of the percentage of the total toll revenue generated that will be generated by Rhode Island vehicles?
It's looking, in our analysis, in the actual over summer truck counts that we did, that actually analyzed also their origins, that about 60% of the revenue would be coming from out-of-state vehicles passing through Rhode Island.
Thank you. Questions from the committee? Senator Felag.
Thank you very much, Director. You threw a lot of terms at us, and I just want to make sure I get the proper terminology of what you're speaking about. When you say the infrastructure, you're just talking about the bridges, correct, not the roads?
Well, Roadworks is a comprehensive plan. While a concentration and one of the main objectives is to bring our bridges into a state of good repair, because that poses the largest health and safety risk, frankly, that we have in front of us. The 10-year plan in the out years, and much of that is will be accomplished because of the surge that we're talking about. And the good news is that with this additional revenue stream, it provides the additional funding we need to care for all elements. If you go back a couple of slides, please. To where we showed the use of the resources. Oh, nobody's there. Okay. A couple more. Back. Right there. Okay. So this is the entire $4.7 billion roadworks program. The bridges is this blue down here. But it also includes a considerable amount of paving. And you can see over time how the money that's available for paving projects increases, okay? So with transit, bike path ADA, and drainage and traffic safety issues. But roadworks also includes a maintenance component.
It's very important that we increase not only these other parts of our infrastructure. So when I talk about infrastructure, it's all inclusive of all of our transportation systems, but also inclusive of a proper maintenance capability that at the end of this, after this enormous investment that we're asking you to make, we'll have in place a maintenance program with the resources to be able to properly maintain this so that, as I said, DOT directors in the future won't have to come to you with a state of poor repair as I have.
Thank you very much. And the reason why I asked that question is because a couple of years ago we were here with Senator Palmer, and he worked diligently with the DOT, and he came up with what was called the Highway Maintenance Fund.
Yes.
And that fund now is generating maybe $36 million this year, $53 next year, going up to $500 million within roughly a seven-year period.
Yes.
So I wanted to ensure that that's part of the overall, and that's not really money that can be diverted from there to the bridges.
No, we're not intending it. It's part of the...
constituents called me up relative to that. Now,
where we are relying on that being there as part of this program.
Okay, thank you.
And that, by the way, I'm glad you mentioned that, because when you look at the tolling part of this, tolling makes up only a portion of the whole funding mechanism. And as you said, the Article 21 funding, the federal funding, are all key components of the roadworks plan.
All right, so now getting back to your presentation, it said crumbling infrastructure, and so now we're focusing in on the bridges, mm-hmm. correct?
They're of grave concern.
Correct. Now, your slide 8 talked about three different aspects. It talked about preservation and maintenance, which I assume is scrubbing the bridges and doing whatever it takes to keep that bridge up to snuff so it survives.
Actually, in the way that we're using it in that slide, there are three different methods of actual construction needs at different stages of a bridge's reconstruction. Preventative maintenance would be categorized as, for example, a repainting of a rusting bridge, because if that rusting continues, you get into the phase of needing to do a rehabilitation at some point, and if you don't do anything about it there, it eventually transitions into full decay, where you need to actually reconstruct the whole bridge.
Exactly. So I'm saying there's three different components. There's that preservation or maintenance.
Yes.
There's that repair or rehabilitation.
Right.
And then there's the third component that's either replace or reconstruction.
Correct.
Correct. So there's three things. And you mentioned that in that slide number 2, that one-fifth of our 1,100 bridges are structurally deficient.
Correct.
Now, when you say structurally deficient, does that mean that it's repairable, or does it mean it's constructible, or does it mean that it's maintenance?
Yeah. If it's structurally deficient, and I'll defer to our structural engineer on this, but my reading of it is most of the 150 bridges that are structurally deficient that will be repaired in this fall into the higher categories, many of them into reconstruction, and some of them in the rehabilitation phases.
And then the
other 500 will fall into the rehabilitation and maintenance kind of activities that will cost us less now, that if we don't fix them now, we'll quickly go. You saw how quickly that curve.
Well, that's the point I'm trying to ascertain or to get out of you is the fact that we have these different categories.
Yes.
of preservation, rehabilitation, and repairing and reconstruction.
Right.
But then we categorize those bridges as either structurally deficient, blah 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 blah. I'm assuming.
Yes.
Right. So
I get your meaning.
So in other words, we're trying to say that if we don't do something, that slide number 8 tells us that those bridges start to get in greater disrepair
and higher.
If we don't put the money in it, and it's going to cost us more later on.
By the way, $950 million more by compressing the bridge reconstruction. That's precisely where the savings are coming, by catching more of these bridges at that early stage.
So that's the big reason why we need that surge in money, in your
Correct.
Estimation.
Exactly.
Because if we don't have the surge, then if someone says pay-as-you-go or this or that, that means that we're going to have to save up that money maybe to get to that point.
There you go. And even after paying the interest on it, there's a net savings of $700 million by doing that surge.
Okay, and here's my last
question. That's the reason for that upfront borrowing.
And here's my last question. Is DOT ready to do this project?
Oh, yes.
In terms of, do we have the shovel-ready projects? Do we have the DOT staffing that
yep.
we need? Do we have the construction documents, construction designs, construction RFPs in place to bring this forward?
Absolutely. Do we have a slide queued on the past year's construction? Okay. So we looked at the last couple of decades of construction that went on at DOT. And during the last couple of decades, there were years that actually exceed the contract amounts that we anticipate under roadworks. Under the ARRA funding, we had one year that went higher than any of the ones that we anticipate in our. So it's not a question of whether we can deliver. What we're reconstructing, while we're reconstructing the bridges, we've already started reconstructing DOT. And we're reconstructing it in a way that not only will get those projects out, but will get them out cheaper, faster, better than we've done in the past. You'll be hearing from industry and labor experts after this testimony that will tell you the state of readiness with regard to the contractors and labor forces that are out there is more than adequate to handle the kinds of projects that we're and the rate of funding that we're providing.
And one last point is that I'm sure these structurally deficient bridges have to have some engineer go out there constantly or periodically to ensure they haven't
yes.
depaired to a state of closing that particular bridge, correct?
Right. Correct. And on that note, one of the big changes that we're making in DOT is to bring over $10 million of consulting fees that we're paying for those inspections. This isn't even planning and designing the fix. It's $10 million a year just inspecting the ones to make sure that they're not going to fall down, okay? We're bringing those functions in-house, or a good amount of that in-house, by recreating a bridge inspection group inside DOT to lower the cost and do a better job at those inspections. You're welcome.
Director Alviti.
Would you like a water first?
Would you like a drink? Oh, I would, very much. Of all days, I forgot to take my allergy pill this morning.
That wasn't
so
my only question.
What you're hearing is that. Thank you. Next.
Director, has counsel for the Department of Transportation or the Governor's Office rendered a legal opinion regarding the Dormant Commerce Clause and whether or not it's applicable to this proposal?
Yes. Actually we've had a law firm with international expertise on these issues working with us from day one of this program back in, I think we engaged them originally back in the spring, and they sit in on our daily meetings, and any discussions on the changes, nuances, or planning of any aspect of this program, they've overseen. The governor's legal staff has also taken a separate look, and we have in-house lawyers that have sat in on every day's meetings with the engineers, with the planners, and with our finance people to make sure that we're within our legal rights with regard to the Commerce Clause,
respectfully,
in particular, among other things.
Respectfully, I would ask that before the full Senate or this committee votes on this, that you have legal counsel take a look at Section 42.13.112, which is the section that deals with toll evaders. You're mm-hmm. proposing a $3,000 fine
Yet, if you are a toll evader on the Newport Bridge, it's a $500 fine.
Mm-hmm.
There is an argument that you are treating interstate commerce differently.
Yeah, we've already had them look at that, as a matter of fact. Good question.
All right.
When we first started discussions with both the state police and the state traffic commission, we also had our attorneys render an opinion on whether or not the posting of no-through truck signs in order to mitigate diversion from the tolling routes would conflict with the constitutional or the clause and the law that you just mentioned. The finding was, and we also reached out to Federal Highway. Federal Highway has restrictions on placing those kinds of traffic controls on certain roadways in the National Highway System. We, our consultants that have also been on board since spring that are conducting the traffic modeling and traffic counts and computer analysis that goes with the diversion, you know, the expected diversion and potentially the routes that that diversion may take place on, show to us that we wouldn't be placing these traffic controls on any of the highways in the National Highway System. Therefore, we'd be in full compliance with both federal and state law in doing that.
All right. Director, you made the comment that these trucks, particularly these out-of-state trucks, are causing damage on our roads. Do you, as part of this plan, I fail to see, and maybe it's in a separate document, but are you looking at our construction specifications? Are we building our roads adequately?
Funny you should mention that.
It's not funny.
Because, well, it is to me. In addition to the destruction that the trucks are causing, if you look at the very construction of a bridge, the size of the beams, the size of the columns, the thickness of the deck and the kind of reinforcing that has to go into it is largely controlled by the weight of these larger vehicles. And therefore, the cost increases considerably for us to have to build a bridge that supports a large commercial vehicle than we would have to pay to build a bridge simply for commuter vehicles.
As part of this comprehensive 10-year plan, are we looking at any construction of way stations in the state of Rhode Island, since overweight trucks, it's your testimony, are causing damage?
We have way stations throughout. Roadworks doesn't call for the construction of any new way stations.
And do we have, I don't see anything in here where the state police will be in conjunction with their mobile way people. Have you had any discussions with the state police to be cracking down on out of state?
We have. As a matter of fact, we've met with both the state police and the traffic commission to let them know our intention of going forward with this. And while the actual implementation of the tolls themselves, the gantries and the switch of the tolls going on, is over a year and a half away from now, we've already started not only with them but with local communities beginning to coordinate the effort that it will take in order to police and enforce these no-through trucking restrictions.
Thank you. Page 6 of 16, Section 8, line 29 reads, according to the United States General Accounting Office, just one fully loaded five-axle tractor trailer has the same impact on interstate as 9,600 automobiles. Mm-hmm. And you actually referenced that fact during your talk.
Yes.
Your testimony. Do you know where that quote came from?
Where that what?
Do you know where that quote came from?
Yeah, I think it's right in a GAO report. I
have it. Thank you. It's a 1979 report.
Yes.
Okay. Has anything changed in the last 40 years? Allow me, please.
Yep.
Road specifications, mm-hmm. tires, the way axles are constructed. I'm offended by putting this into a statute. A 40-year-old quotation, when I can go online to, and I did, the University of Texas and can pull down a 1999 report that says it's less than 1,000 or arguably 2,000 cars rather than 9,600.
How many cars?
Less than 2,000.
Okay.
And I'm not saying that's not a big number, but you're asking me to put a 40-year-old quotation into a general law.
So here's the thing. We've got no less than six reports that puts the amount of damage that is done by trucks, heavy commercial vehicles, Class 8 and larger, at between 70 and 99.7%. Depends on which of the expert reports that you quote. I will tell you this. The Newtonian physics on which that 1970 report was based haven't changed for quite some time. Gravity is still gravity. Force is still force. In the same way Newton set it forth, our engineers and even our nuclear physicists to this day are still using those laws of physics in the same way.
I want to use a quote that you stated, which is that the opponents of this have used scare tactics. I would opine that you're using a scare tactic by putting that in the general statutes of the state of Rhode Island when you could simply say that trucks impact the interstate greater than automobiles do. I think by using a 40-year-old law, we're being disingenuous. That's my commentary. Can you explain to this committee how this is going to work? Who's going to collect the funds, and how's it going to end up? You call for a restricted fund that has a new name, the Restricted Bridge Account Fund. Is that going to be separate and different than the highway maintenance account?
Yes.
So it is separate and distinct from the highway maintenance account?
Yes.
Okay. So explain to me, the statute commences by amending the Rhode Island Bridge and Turnpike Authority section of the law and then creates a new section known as the bridge, we'll call it the Rhode Island Bridge Replacement Construction and Maintenance Fund. Why are we amending the Rhode Island Bridge and Turnpike Authority statute?
I believe we're doing that to have us be inclusive in their program, their existing program.
And why do we need that?
Well, because they're adding the services that they would provide to us, to their services.
Can you explain to everybody that interaction between the Bridge and Turnpike Authority and DOT?
The intended interaction is simply to make use of their existing knowledge base. They have knowledge, and they've already gone through the learning curve on the technology, setting up the various accounting systems, the computer systems, and are enrolled in various national programs that where states share information on tolling that would preclude us from having to go through the additional expense of reinventing the wheel. So why would we spend all of that money all over again separately when the Bridge and Turnpike has already spent that money and has gone through that process?
And why
are basically it's to save money.
Why are we calling for a competitive negotiation when you described the bid process in your testimony?
Please explain that more.
Section 42.13.110, procurement of toll facilities. Notwithstanding any requirement of law to the contrary, the department may award such contracts on the basis of competitive negotiation in accordance with 37.219.
Okay. I think I said as part of the presentation, one of the prime areas that we're looking at the possibility of using a P3 in order to create the best project pipeline that we can for the project is in the implementation of the tolling system. The gantries, the siting of the gantries, the construction of the gantries,
the inclusion of the various equipment that goes on the gantries, and ultimately the integration of that equipment into a computerized system that collects the information and turns it into actual billing. All of the various components of that provide a very good opportunity for us to use a P3 kind of project delivery solution. This is precisely, as I said, to think is P3 as a solution for the entire program, I think is unrealistic from my experience. And I've only had, about 30 years of experience in P3 development. I've only lectured across the entire country, and I've only co-authored a book on privatization. But aside from that experience, it tells me that the tolling gantry and the tolling technology part of our project is one of those areas that we might consider using a P3 to get the best product for the lowest price and to eliminate a lot of the risk that goes into finger pointing between the technology suppliers and the builders of the gantries.
Competitive negotiation.
That is how a P3 is properly developed.
Competitive negotiation, accordance with 37.219, right, requires that you can competitively negotiate if there's only a sole source. Are there more than one parties?
We expect that. Our intention is to open it to more than one party. Absolutely.
Right. So then,
we expect the gantry the gantry kind of project to attract a good number of companies.
Why is this section in the proposed statute if you're acknowledging there's more than one and the requirement of competitive negotiation is sole source?
No, a requirement of competitive negotiation is that once you have selected through the competitive process the best company with the best deal, you can then further negotiate down their fees.
Okay. Section 4213.18, the amount of tolls. It says the department's authority to fix and adjust the amount of tolls shall be determined by the cost of replacement, reconstruction, maintenance, operation, a Rhode Island system of bridges, and any portion or portions thereof, including costs associated with the acquisition, construction, operation, maintenance of the toll facilities, and administrative costs in connection therewith. Mm-hmm. You are unilaterally charged with many sections of this proposed law. Would you agree with that statement?
Yes, I am.
All right.
If I could just interject here. There is one component that is still language that is still under discussion between the Senate, the House, and the administration as it relates to the legislature's oversight over certain aspects of this. So what I don't want to do is any more time on that aspect of it. For one, because we do have additional questions from other senators,
yep,
and we do have a long list. So as it relates to the oversight or eventual oversight component of it, I just want to – it's stated that that's still a work in progress.
I appreciate that, Mr. Chairman. Then I'll just go to this question. It's your position that right now it's 14 gantry locations, but according to this proposed, anywhere on the national highway system that's located within the state of Rhode Island, a gantry could be located. Is that correct?
No.
How so?
The location of federal law restricts the location of a gantry to be in direct relationship to the bridge for which it's providing the funding for reconstruction or rehabilitation.
Okay. Have you drawn the opinion or the conclusion of the totality of this 10-year plan? Once you fix a bridge, mm-hmm, the toll presumably pays for that construction. Is that the position?
Correct.
Okay. And what happens once you achieve that cost?
Federal law goes on to say that once the authorized body, DOT in this case, determines that the needs of that bridge have been met,
that the toll link revenue can be used for other transportation, Title 23 purposes only. That is, it can only be used for additional transportation funding.
Okay. And can you talk about, you said $45 million in year one, if I heard you correctly, on the gantries?
$45 million in each of the 10 years, yes.
And how much will it cost to install the gantries?
About $2 million.
Per?
Per gantry, right.
Okay, so $28 million?
Thereabouts.
Thereabouts.
I mean, there'll be a range. Depending upon the width and location, it could be between $2 and $3 million, but yes.
Do we have any intention of recycling the gantry that's currently standing on the Saconic River Bridge?
I do.
You do?
Yes.
Okay.
And that could very well be
a different location.
That could very well be the first gantry that goes up in a different location.
I'd like
not,
to qualify.
Not in the location that it's in.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Senator Sosnowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Director, for your comments this evening and your work on this. And I'm glad, number one, you're glad to hear about recycling. I think I had asked you about that last year.
Yes, you did.
Very glad.
I think I gave you the same answer.
Yes, you did.
Yeah, we'll be reusing that sucker.
Thank you. I just had a couple of very brief questions. Looking at the sad news that you gave us about the state of the bridges, this comes from one of my constituents, a question. If I know you said DOT is ready to go once this gets approved.
Yes.
Do you have a list of top 10 bridges?
As a matter of fact, as part of the 10-year program, on our website is a list of every project that we will be doing for the next 10 years.
Okay.
By year.
By year, okay.
Yes.
Very good.
And location.
Okay, thank
as
you.
As a matter of fact, almost as specific as bridge number.
Excellent, thank you.
You're welcome.
And just one other question, and I think Chairman DuPont clarified that as far as there's still some ongoing negotiations as far as state oversight on this. And I did have a couple of questions as far as the Rhode Island Bridge Replacement Reconstruction and Maintenance Fund established, which is a new restricted receipt account, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And you also said there would be a restricted receipt account for each bridge. Going
yes.
Forward?
Yes.
Okay. And these are good things. I just wanted to reiterate that.
Yes.
And
well, they're necessary, too, but...
Yeah, though it's very good because my constituents are very concerned about that funding. As far as you mentioned the Federal Transportation Secretary will be conducting audits on the fund or
yes.
The money. Well, do you know if those audits are usually conducted annually or is it on project?
No,
I don't know at this point.
I'm going to assume if they're anything like the regular federal highway audits that we have, that's on an annual basis.
On an annual basis. So at a minimum, we will have the Federal Transportation Secretary conducting audits, and then there still is the possibility that we will have some state.
The Department of Administration will be performing separate audits.
Okay. Thank you very much,
yes.
Mr. Director. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Director Alvini, for your presentation today. I have got three very easy questions for you. So
with that.
One, we've been talking about tolls for many years, and we started out the discussion with a belief that we couldn't toll the roads in Rhode Island because when the interstate highway system was built, Rhode Island did not participate financially in the construction of that highway. Does that sound?
That's actually still true.
Okay, so is it because we're tolling or putting tolls approximately in the area of these deficient bridges that we're able to get permission, if you will, from the federal government?
Right. In addition to restricting the use of the proceeds to the reconstruction of those bridges, too. So there are two ways, spatially and financially. The tolls, the gantries and the tolls that are collected are linked to the bridge.
Okay, thank you. And I travel up and down the East Coast frequently, and I remember one time I had a problem with my Easy Pass, and I got a photo in the mail of my license plate.
There you go.
So it's a very accurate and detailed system. Mm-hmm. But having trucks going through of different sizes mixed in with cars, mm-hmm. small trucks, whatever, have you had discussions with the people who provide these gantries and Easy Pass where you're confident that they can separate the big trucks from the medium trucks from
yes. Yeah, we brought on a consultant early on in the process to help us develop the program and develop traffic counts, and they have also lent us their expertise with regard to how finite it could be. One of the reasons that we have Rhode Island Bridge and Turnpike as part of the legislation is they also have this kind of experience where they toll trucks at a different rate than they toll automobiles. And they're making those same kind of differentiations. The technology is very precise in terms of differentiating between truck classes and types.
Right. Thank you. And a final question. Slide 21, it just shows basically from Rhode Island down to Maryland, the different costs per
yes.
mile. And it ends in Maryland. And is that because the tolls basically end in Maryland?
No.
My experience is the tolls do end in Maryland, except for some specialty tolls on the, I call it the gauntlet or below Washington, D.C.,
yes.
where the mixing bowl, it's also called,
right.
where 20 lanes merge into 18 to 10, to whatever.
Right.
And then North Carolina, South Carolina, no tolls. So,
not on the interstate, but they have them on other roads, toll roads in their highway system.
Yeah, there are private roads that are tolled. Mm-hmm. I know of one in North Carolina, mm-hmm. and there's one in Virginia, which I believe goes out
right.
to Dulles Airport.
Right.
But in general,
I think Florida also has a toll.
Florida Turnpike has a toll.
Florida Turnpike has a toll.
But generally speaking, except for those private toll roads, I believe once you get south of Washington, the interstates are toll-free.
Yeah, I think particularly Interstate 95, you may be correct.
Yes, okay. Thank you for your testimony.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Director, I assume you're going to stick around for a while.
I'm here for as long as you need me.
What's Senator Pagarini?
Director, if this is a 10-year plan, why do we need the financing up front? Why not do what you need to do in phase one and then borrow 5 years from now?
Well, the borrowing is the fuel for that initial surge. The real savings from accelerating the bridge, particularly the bridge reconstruction part of this program, the savings in doing that is if you can go back to this curve here, that, the curve on bridge life cycle. Consider that we have 650 bridges over the next 10 years we're gonna fix. And every one of them, the shape and size may change. This is this work particular on Greenwich Avenue in Wall. But every one of them has this curve. Okay? Our engineers
we've got quite a group of very highly intelligent people.
They have one of these curves for every one of those bridges. Okay? And in developing the program, we asked them
if you had the appropriate funding, how would you accomplish fixing 650 bridges
where at different points in the life cycle with every one of them for the least amount of money, as opposed to the traditional way that we've been doing it? We waited until our bridges get to here before we fix them. Okay? And they took the 650 bridges and programmed them through an iterative process over that 10-year period and did a mix of projects where we were catching them at this point in the curve instead of at this point, mixed in with projects that are already at this point that aren't going to change much because they're already in a state of decay. By doing that,
they found that they could accomplish a $950 million savings in those 650 bridge projects if they could do a good number of them up front, if you could show the funding. It's right at the end. That $950 million in savings comes from creating this surge of reconstruction and compressing the number of projects we do, so we're catching bridges before they get into that very costly stage. And
if I may,
the borrowing that we're doing, that you're asking about, is necessary in order to fund that surge.
When you talked about the 14 bridges that you repaired last year under the current budget, and then 14 new ones became in need.
Yes.
What's the factor for that in this plan? You've got 1,100 bridges.
Yeah, there you go. Go back to the I think the second or third slide where we show the road works versus traditional approach. If we continue to fix them in the same way we have, so that we're fixing the worst ones, but as many as we fix continually. That was a good year last year. Traditionally, you can see at the current rate of funding, or basically a pay-as-you-go kind of thing that we've been doing in the past, we will go from one out of every five bridges to one out of every two bridges.
My question is, there's 500 bridges that you're not attending to under this plan. Is that correct? You said we have 1,100
yes,
plus.
Yes, because they're way at the beginning of that life cycle.
10 years from now, 7 years from now.
They'll still be in the early phase.
You're saying they won't require anything but for maintenance?
That's correct. If we, as a matter of fact, the reason that part of roadworks, we're spending money to increase our maintenance capability, is that at the end of this period of time, we will have an adequate maintenance force to be able to properly maintain those bridges and increase their lifespan. Now, there is a point in time where, because of the impact of heavy vehicles, every bridge will still, you can't maintain a bridge indefinitely and have it last forever. There is a point in time at which the very material itself begins to fatigue because of the flexure of particularly heavy vehicles going over it. And every bridge will still have to be redone at some point. The good news is that with the additional revenue coming from the tolling, if it's continued through those years, the funding will be in place to do that. On a timely basis, always at a point when those bridges are still in a manageable cost time frame.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator DePalma?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director, thank you for being here. Clearly, a lot of work's been accomplished since, I'm a certain, May of last year.
Yes.
Thanks to your team. Thanks for the governor and all the work that you put in. Clearly, the bill we have before us is, although last year was a good bill, this is even better based on the work that was done.
Senator, it's really the same bill.
I understand, but
the only changes to it are the changes we've made financially in the financial planning of it because of the additional federal funding.
And we can't underestimate and thank our congressional delegation for whatever they did or didn't do.
Yep.
And bringing the additional money in the FAST Act, the additional $20 million up, ramping up to $30 million per year in the out years. Clearly, that's obviously the big driver. And if we thought anything the biggest change in this, obviously that's the biggest change.
Yes.
So thanks for the work that you've done. I always say from a legislative perspective or executive branch perspective, we need to hear, we need to listen, and we need to act. I think we've heard from constituents. I think you've heard from Rhode Island residents, from
yes.
businesses, et cetera, about how to improve this. I think that's been done based on all the changes the leader articulated earlier, you reiterated in your presentation, et cetera. I think it comes down to, for me, it's four areas. I do have a question at the end, but sort of some commentary in front.
Okay.
It's a safety, it's an economics, and it's a equity and fairness perspective.
Yes.
And I've said this before, and I'll state it again here. I'm not from Rhode Island, though I've been here 32 years now and a half. Really from Connecticut. And if anybody wants to look up, they can look up the Mianus River Bridge in Connecticut.
Oh.
I-95, major thoroughfare, taking traffic from Connecticut to New York and back. I think it was 1983. You're a graduate from college, so it was a long time ago. A section of that bridge fell into the water. People died.
Yep.
Knock on wood, It never happens here, but from a safety perspective, and in fact, if you, some things I read about it, can't always agree everything you read or believe everything you read, that issue is driven by drainage that supposedly wasn't cleared. Mm-hmm. That caused water to go in another area, which caused bolts and pins and however it was built to deteriorate. Tractor trailer went over, people died, people about five people down, cars went over the edge. And this can never happen in Rhode Island. So the quicker we can get this done and get this over the goal line, the better, because it's an issue no one wants to be able to talk about and say, you should have, you could have, why didn't you? So I applaud you for moving this forward.
Senator, that is the first thing that I think about in the morning and the last thing that I think about before I go to bed, being placed into the position that I'm in. Ultimately, the health and safety with regard to these structures ends up with me. An event that happened last summer in a small bridge, the Park Avenue Bridge in Cranston, was pretty much one of those circumstances where here you had a small bridge span. It was a wooden bridge structure. We got the report that it was in imminent danger. There was 16,000 volt railroad high tension conduit below the bridge, suspended from below the bridge. I think a 16-inch gas main running across the bridge on one side of the bridge, and a 12-inch water pipe going across on the other side, and a middle school within sight distance that school buses were going over every day. And I didn't think of all of those elements while we were analyzing the status of the bridge and the decision to close it. But later on in reflection, the possibility of a loaded bus going over a bridge causing a failure with a gas line, a high tension electrical line, and a water line all potentially breaking at the same time, and that mixture, is real. It's a real problem. It was a real occurrence that happened. This isn't things that we think of could happen, should have happened, would have happened, but for the sake of someone catching it at the point that they did, and us closing that bridge at the time, could have become the kind of occurrence that you referred to. And I'm glad you pointed that out, because that really is what this is all about. We can talk about economy, we can talk about, and there are a lot of good things that will flow from this program, but ultimately that's what we're talking about.
I think it's easy in what was done over the years to say, let's wait, let's push us down, kick the can down the road, and take care of it next year.
No more.
So whether it's our kids, and I'll say it here, in a couple months I'll have a grandchild, so we're going to have kids and kids in the future. We're doing this for the future, not necessarily for us.
Right.
By the time the people are going to benefit from this, they're going to be those that are going to come after us. It's a hard thing to do. It's the right thing to do. A couple other comments. I think the other section of bridges is functionally obsolete. Having studied this quite a bit over the last number of years with Senator Pichardo and others, there's structurally deficient, functionally obsolete, and we have a bunch of those as well. But going back to Article 21 from a couple of years ago, your predecessor and the group that was the commission that was formed and looking at that, it was a $1 billion problem. And if you can go back and read their report, Director Lewis said $1 billion problem.
Mm-hmm.
What did we accomplish in Article 21? About half of that.
Say it again.
We accomplished about half of that. If we look at, as Senator Felix said earlier, over the 10 years,
by the way,
it's about $500
One of the best things that ever happened for the state was Article 21, because it set us into the mode of thinking that we need to begin to work our way out of taking every penny that we're taking as revenue into DOT and just paying debt with it.
So it actually took DMV money, all gas tax money, et cetera, moved it to transportation. So what this seeks to do is complement that to address that approximate billion-dollar
issue. That's exactly what this does.
I do want to get to a question, two questions for you. One will be about risk in one other area, but if you can reuse that seconded toll tomorrow, that would be phenomenal. So you should put that on the list. That's the first gantry that goes.
Say that again, please.
Take the Sakana toll tomorrow and
yes.
bring it somewhere. It'd be phenomenal.
Just I think, as a matter of fact, it's scheduled for the day after the bill passes.
Excellent. So just going back to, from an engineering perspective, Newtonian physics, while the report was built, written in 79, the interstate was built in the 60s. So we're talking about an interstate that's been in existence for 50 years.
Yes.
While new studies have shown lower weights and lower impacts, the infrastructure we have today is 50 years old, built back when we were looking to transport national troops.
That's exactly right.
Across the country in a nuclear deterrent kind of time to get those folks from point A to point B.
Right.
So from a Newtonian physics perspective, the 9,600 times still applies,
yep.
given the infrastructure of 50, 60 years ago.
Well, the bridges that we're fixing fit precisely in the time frame that report was done.
Right. So one specific question, because I'm going to bring up the oversight, and I'm glad Senator Pagliarini and others have brought up about the oversight piece, and Senator DuPont. In the bill, it talks about the assessment of the toll per gantry, each gantry once per day.
Yes.
So the question, I know it's in the minutia, how is a day defined? From a trucking perspective, is a day defined? It doesn't make a difference.
From our assessment of the tolls perspective, it's 12 midnight to 12 midnight.
It is. So it's a calendar
it's
day.
It's a calendar
day. It's not a 24-hour period.
No.
Okay. Last question. From your perspective, sitting as the director of DOT, what do you think the biggest risk of the entire roadworks program is?
That's a good question.
Not two or three. I've gone through the – by the way, I'm glad you put the plan online. Last October, the asset management plan that's there, all 600 pages, and as Senator Fazowski asked a question earlier, you can go see your favorite road and find out when that road's going to be done and how much money it is per year. So thanks for putting that there.
But that eliminates a lot of the risk, huh? And putting the funding with it, putting the appropriate funding with that plan, which is what Roadworks does, will do,
what's the one
eliminates the risk. One of the biggest risks would be to do nothing, but in terms of executing the program, I think what you're talking about.
Yes.
One of the biggest risks in executing the program is there are uncontrollable circumstances that happen out there, and in particular, I'm referring to the safety aspects of some. We know what the condition of our bridges is now. Okay, we will monitor that very closely. As a matter of fact, when I came in, one of the first things that I did was put in to effect an emergency bridge inspection program. Okay, one of the biggest risks associated with this kind of work is the accuracy and of those reports and how well they define the actual condition under those bridges. There are UCs in this business. There are uncontrollable circumstances. There are subsurface conditions that we may not observe. There are occurrences such as strikes by heavy vehicles. There are many sorts of uncontrollable weather-related kinds of conditions that could exist that could potentially accelerate one or two of these bridges into a state faster than we anticipate them evolving, faster than that curve that I showed you evolving, or that would move them swiftly into a failure mode. And that's the biggest risk. Risk is not being fast enough, even with this program.
I guess if I'd ask, based on those risks and based on the best business practice perspective, which you've obviously been doing this a long time,
yeah.
if we can look at what mitigation steps we should put in place
yes.
to address those risks. So in the case of subsurface, can you do some borings or whatever to say, let's take a look at what people, if we replace a sidewalk in the town, we do borings along the way to say, does it have a foundation or not? It does. No, it doesn't. So costs go up or down. I think we might want to look and see how do we factor that in to help us give an appreciation for when we go and open up that road and you're like, oh, my goodness, I didn't expect this. Why didn't we know?
We'll certainly heed that advice. We're already implementing a number of those things, because we're looking for the, we're continuously looking at the backups, the belts and suspenders. And one of the things we're doing in that regard is implementing an in-house bridge inspection crew and increasing our staffing and capabilities and equipment that's necessary in order to keep timely inspection so that we can monitor the decay so that if any of those UCs happens, we see them coming.
Thank you. Thanks for the work and thanks for all the efforts to date.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Pichardo, and then we're going to move on to the rest of the witness list.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome.
I know we're coming to the end, but one specific question I had, as you highlight the Route 610 as leaving from the city to outward.
Yes.
Have you had any conversation or are there any plans working with the City of Providence to best reroute or look at ways to shorten those bottlenecks that form leaving the downtown or the area?
Yes.
And then the second thing is, maybe I missed it, for how long are the tolls, is there a sunset on the in the bill that the tolls will stop at a certain year? Mm-hmm. How many years is it going to, and is that described on the bill?
Okay.
Or how do you foresee that?
So in answer to your first question, yes. We have had some preliminary discussions with not only the City of Providence, but also some transit organizations and with regard to the 610 improvements. I believe the City of Providence has scheduled for March, a kind of charrette or kind of public forum at which we'll be participating also to begin to collect ideas and views of people. But the Route 610 process itself will involve, because it includes many forms of funding, state, federal, transit, federal, highway, will include in it many public participation kinds of elements. So we'll continuously monitor and listen to what people want, what form they'd like to see it take, and kind of bang that up against what we can afford and what we can deliver to them. In answer to your second question, what was your second question?
So in terms of outgoing years,
oh, yes,
is
the
there
tolls.
A sunset?
So there is no sunset in the bill that we're proposing. Frankly, I think the dedicated and reliable kind of funding that it provides an element to our state's transportation funding that many other states already have. We're one of the states that depends on federal funding for transportation more than most other states. And this will begin to close that gap where the state is taking on more of the responsibility, at least in line with most other states. That kind of reliable and dedicated funding will help prevent this from happening again. It'll help prevent us getting into that cycle that, when we look at the previous several decades, have gone up and down incredibly over the years, depending upon what the legislature provides for funding. That kind of up and down funding is not the kind of funding that you need in order to do long-range planning and proper maintenance of a transportation infrastructure, particularly as in the future we move into the transit and rail kind, looking to transit and rail for expansion of our transportation system. That kind of long-term funding to support the needs of the highway and bridges will allow us the freedom to use the rest of the funding that comes in, non-toll revenue, to meet those other needs that we have. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Director. We're going to move on to the witness list. I have some folks that I believe are watching in the room due to the capacity constraints of this room. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call up the witnesses, and then I'll call up who are going to be the next two in case those folks are down in the other room. They have time to make it up here. I'm going to call up first witness, Senator Mark Cody.
Thank you, Madam Chair, Mr. Chairman. I say Madam President more than Mr. Chairman. I'm here this afternoon on behalf of the people of District 24, Woonsocket North Smithfield, to express opposition to the roadworks plan, in particular the component having to do with the use of the tolling and gantries. I believe that as a General Assembly and Department of Commerce, we're seeking to make Rhode Island perceived and actually a more business-friendly state. And I believe that the implementation and construction of gantries and tolling inherently works against creating the image that we are, in fact, a business-friendly state as it relates to interstate commerce, trucking coming through our state, et cetera. Also, we're making investment in gantries, which I believe is in the $40-plus million range, which those resources could be put into actual physical construction versus tolling infrastructure. We're also, by going away with the gantries, would totally eliminate the diversion issue, the cost of monitoring diversion, the public safety costs of enforcement, and the wear and tear on secondary roads that come with diversion inherently. So I believe a big, big benefit by avoiding using gantries and tolls is eliminating the cost of diversion. And I also believe, but I am here also to say that we believe that an alternate pay-as-you-go alternative would be preferred, speaking again for the people that I represent. We, in 2014, passed the budget for the 2015 budget to provide a long-term solution to funding road and bridge maintenance by making changes to transportation funding. These changes are currently estimated to yield more than $60 million annually, in addition to transportation funding once fully implemented in 2019. In the upcoming year, is scheduled to have $33.2 million available as a result of passage of that legislation, which could be resources used to improve our roads. In addition, we recently learned that we are getting an additional $21 million in federal funding that we did not anticipate. So that, along with the 33.2, is $55 million that could go, again, directly towards improving our roads and bridges. The former proposal had a provision that provided a tax credit to the trucking industry in the state as basically compensation for the negative effects of implementation of the tolling plan in the state on our state's trucking industry. That is not in the current plan, so it raises basically two questions. This, I think, rather than devote that money to tax credits, devoting that money from our budget to improvements would be a better use of the money. And by the fact that we've done away with the tolls and the gantries, then takes off the table the concern of our domestic trucking industry on the impact on their business. There's no doubt that this plan can't be received by the Rhode Island trucking industry as being a favorable alternate than what was originally put in. The truckers talked about a potential increase in the diesel tax. I don't think that's necessarily something we want to do if we want to be pro-business. But the bottom line is, I think, and I'm offering this strictly as a suggested framework for a potential pay-as-you-go alternative that I think the people of this state would much prefer than the prospect of facing tolls, the negative impact it causes on business, and putting more resources into the actual construction itself. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Cody. Any questions from the committee? Thank you. Next up, Senator Elaine Morgan, and on deck will be
Thank you, Mr. Chair and committee members. I'm here to represent my District 34, which is Hopkinton, Richmond, Exeter, West Greenwich, and Charlestown. We, as a district, I have just been bombarded with telephone calls and emails. I'm here to represent my taxpayers and my constituents. We agree. We all agree our bridges are in disrepair. They need to be repaired. They're in horrible conditions. But as a business owner, I'm looking at the cost that it's going to impose on small businesses and large businesses. Everything that will be brought into the state comes on a truck, basically. They're going to pass off the cost to us. We're going to be paying more for our furniture, for our milk, for everything. This isn't a business-friendly plan at all. I didn't even see the RPG's proposal on Director Alviti's list there. We have a proposal to take 1% of our total yearly budget and put it toward, and it's just taking a little bit from the fat and excess that we have in our budget. There's a lot of fat and excess in our budget that we can use, and it's 1% to fix it. We can start tomorrow. We won't have to wait to get the bonds. We won't have to bond anything. We're not going to owe anything. This is the smart way to do it, not borrowing and borrowing. Our country is in a deficit. Our state is already in a deficit. It's just going to add, and our kids are going to end up paying for this. My stomach is sick listening to the proposal. Mass DOT has a budget of less than $700 million. And they have 10 times the amount of roads or highways and bridges. Rhode Island has a $500 million budget, and we can't do that with that. I'd like to see a line item, all of the DOT money go right into a restricted account for DOT. I know this road plan is supposed to, but we have a bridge work plan that works better, and it comes right out of the budget. I can't see our taxpayers having to pay for this. And over the 20 years, it will be continual. We can't continue to build structures that we don't maintain. And I thank you.
Thank you very much, Senator. Any questions from the committee?
Yeah, one comment.
Senator Felag?
People get confused, I think, when they talk about budgetary items and they talk about a $9 billion budget. When you talk about a 1% cut of a $9 billion budget, you're cutting a lot of federal funding when you're doing that 1%. That's, you know, so when you talk about federal funding and state funding, when you're talking about the percentage monies, you should be talking about what it's called the general revenue funds, which can be anywhere between $3.6 billion to $3.7 billion. So if you're looking to derive, say, $90 million, it may be 2.5% or something like that, if you want to get your facts correct. Okay.
Right. But what's more important, our bridges and our safety, or the fat and waste that's in our budget?
I'm not, I am not disagreeing with what you, I'm just trying to say your premise is wrong, because if you say 1% of the total budget, you're incorporating a lot of federal funds that can't be cut, or if they're cut, then it's not part of that general fund money.
Did you look at the RPG plan?
I never received it.
Okay. Then we're submitting it today. And I really think that we should look at that instead of heavily weighing our state's economy on, and it's going to destroy business. It really is. And legality, how can you tax or toll just out-of-state trucks? And how can you, this isn't Soviet Russia. You're going to stop trucks from getting off the highway? I mean, it doesn't make sense to me. I don't understand how that could happen, but.
As far as the RPG proposal is, we don't have that before us right now. There's a House bill, I know.
The House has it.
We don't have a Senate.
We have it. We're submitting it today.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator DePalma?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Senator, thank you very much. I've read the RPG bill. You can't use the same money twice.
We're not using the same money twice.
Same money is being used twice. I'll talk about the facts and data.
Okay.
As an engineer, I'm going to talk facts and data, not opinion. Having been very familiar with Article 21 from 2014, all the money for the gas tax goes to four places. Four places is RIDOT. RIPTA, underground storage tanks, 3.5 cents goes to the Turnpike and Bridge Authority to address the work that we gave them for the Saconic River Bridge and the Jamestown-Verrazano Bridge. All the gas tax money goes there. The additional 1% we added with regards to Article 21, while 1%, one penny that went up this year based on the Article 21, that also, that's part of the gas tax all going to, none of it goes to the general fund. RPG bill has gas tax money that's already being used for something else to go to this. You can't use the same money twice. It's categorically in
that's
there.
That's right. We're not using the same money twice in that plan.
Senator, I don't want to disagree with you, but it's already being used somewhere else. You can't use it where it's already being used and use it for roadworks. You can't spend the same dollar twice. Secondarily, just to follow up on Senator Felag, with regards to the general revenues of the state, $3.6 billion, two main areas. Over $1 billion goes to what area? Medicaid.
Mm-hmm.
Federal. The other $800-900 million goes to what? Education. So let's say we cut education to District 34.
You have already, and that's another issue. You just cut us $300,000.
District 12 where I have. I had four cities and towns that were all cut. Some of them come
back. Weren't cut as much as our towns were.
We can discuss that. With regards to that, though, the money's got to come from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Education is not where we're going to cut it. We're not going to Medicaid. We did that last year. $70 million out of the budget, out of the general fund budget, total $140 million. The money's got to come somewhere. We already talked two areas that we've cut some money from before. Education, we're increasing because it's the right thing to do. That percentage of gaining the $90 million that you talk about is now down to 9%, not 3%. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and committee.
Elizabeth Seaver up after Elizabeth will be Al Betancourt, followed by Wayne Salisbury and Lynn Spindella.
Thank you, Chairman, members of the committee. Elizabeth Seaver on behalf of the Greater Providence Chamber of Commerce. We're here in support of Senate Bill 2246, introduced by Leader Ruggiero, and the Roadworks Plan as a way to strengthen our infrastructure and improve our business climate. As you've heard at great length by the Director of DOT, our roads and bridges are currently the worst in the nation. We fear that by delaying addressing this problem in a meaningful and sustainable way, that we will incur additional costs to the Rhode Island taxpayers. Well-maintained and reliable highways, roads, and bridges are imperative to our business climate ranking, and they're also become instrumental for businesses in choosing where they want to relocate or maintain their business presence. We believe that this bill is a balanced approach to make sure that our bridges are updated, that they're structurally, they have structural integrity, and that they will be able to be maintained going forward. We want to thank the Senate President, the Speaker, and the Governor for working together and showing leadership on this very important initiative, and I'd be happy to take any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Any questions?
Question, if I may.
Senator Pallarine? I forgot to mention it. So the Senate session is beginning, but whoever is, we're going to continue to work right through. Whoever is in committee will be recorded present on the floor.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
Has the chamber given contemplation to trucking companies within the state of Rhode Island? Do you feel as though this will have a negative effect on any expansion, new facilities, existing companies relocating out of the state? What are you hearing from membership, not just the board, but your members?
While we haven't this exact proposal, we did pull the May proposal, and frankly, our numbers were positive as our membership regarding the roadworks proposal. We are very fortunate to have a very diverse membership at the Greater Providence Chamber of Commerce. However, our board does prioritize supporting initiatives that will improve Rhode Island's business climate and business climate ranking as a whole.
Okay. I know I received, and possibly others received today, a letter from Cumberland Farms objecting to this, citing that they pay diesel tax, they pay their FITA tax, amongst many other taxes that they pay, and they feel as though this is an anti-business proposal. What is the Chamber's reaction when you hear large businesses in the state of Rhode Island voicing objections?
We understand that individual businesses have their specialized concerns relative to this proposal. However, as a whole, the fact of the matter is that we have the worst bridges in the entire United States, and that acts as an anchor on our business climate ranking as a whole for everyone in this state, whether they're a trucking business or not.
I don't believe anybody on this committee has made the statement that we disagree with Director Alviti's presentation, that we do have the worst roads in the state. I think the source or the issue at hand is how do we fund it? And the objection that I expect that we're going to be hearing from further folks giving testimony is that tolls are anti-business, tolls are bad business, but the Providence Chamber of Commerce feels as though that is the way to go. Is that the testimony?
My testimony on behalf of the Greater Providence Chamber of Commerce is in strong support of this proposal.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Al Betancourt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to make it clear that I'm no longer the lobbyist for Rhode Island Farm Bureau. I'm speaking for myself. The Rhode Island Farm Bureau is here. I was just trying to contact them. That's Wayne Salisbury and Lynn Spinella. I haven't been able to reach them. They're someplace in the building. But anyway, I'll get it to my testimony. I just think that this is not a very good idea. And the reason I don't think it's a good idea is because the state is trying to change its image. We're trying to become a business-friendly state. We're trying to tell the public that we're friendly to businesses. And in my way of thinking, what we're doing is we're sending a clear message across the country that Rhode Island is closed for business. We will be the only state in the country, to my knowledge, that has a toll exclusively on commercial vehicles. And listening to the testimony that's been on TV, we were watching it on TV downstairs in the rotunda. That's why it's very hard to hear down there. But what I did hear was that not only are we going to impose these tolls, but when the truckers try to circumvent the tolls, when they try to get by them, we're going to stop them and we're going to fine them. I mean, in essence, what we're doing here is we're declaring war on the commercial trucking industry. And I just think that's wrong. I don't think we should be doing that. We should not be having a toll exclusively for the commercial trucking industry in the state of Rhode Island. It's going to further make our image bad as far as business goes. Now, I'm going to part with my fellow Farm Bureau people and some of the other people that are opposed to these tolls, and I'm going to say I do favor an increase in the gas tax in order to get the money. I think we've got enough money in our budget that we ought to be able to fund our bridges, but I've been up here long enough to know that the leadership is looking for additional funding. So I'm willing to say, okay, for additional funding, let's go with a gas tax increase. But this business of tolls just for commercial trucking, I think, is a step in the wrong direction. And that's basically all I have to say. And I know I know that Wayne and Lynn wanted to speak to you. I'm not sure what they were going to say, but I know that they were going to say something along the lines of that what's going to happen is they're going to increase. We import 99% of our food in this state. We import 99% of our food. That means that we're going to depend on trucking to get our food to us. What are they going to do when they have to pay additional tolls? They're going to tack it on to our food. So we're going to wind up paying more for food in this state than we currently do. So I don't know what else they were going to say, but I know they were going to say that. But I'll entertain any questions.
Thank you, Al. Senator DePalma.
Al, thanks for being here. It's odd you're not part of the Farm Bureau, but it's good that you're here as yourself. I'm going to ask you a question. So you would prefer that we shouldn't just, I'm going to say it this way, we shouldn't just toll trucks, we should toll cars as well?
You know,
I'm just asking.
I just took a trip to Virginia.
Yeah.
And I went through five states,
yeah.
Seven states. Five of them have tolls. And, you know, I've said to the lobbyists for the Department of Transportation in the past that, you know, we see tolls, and again, I'm not talking for Farm Bureau here.
Okay.
We see tolls in every state on the interstate, just about. There's, you can count the number on one hand that probably don't. I don't see why Rhode Island doesn't have a toll on the interstate. But it should be a toll, and it should be something like maybe a dollar an axle. And the people that have easy passes should get a discount like they do now on the Newport Bridge. I would be okay with having one toll on Route 95 in the state of Rhode Island.
So with regard to that, we can't, obviously. Federal.
And that's what blows my mind. We can't have one, but we can have 14.
I don't know if you heard earlier, the director, and I read through the U.S. Code, the U.S. Code basically says it's for that particular bridge that you're going to rebuild. So,
and again, I'm confused about that, too, because the George Washington Bridge has a tremendous amount of traffic on it. I used to go over that bridge every day.
It's different when the bridge is first built as opposed to after the fact, like we saw with the Sakonnet.
No, but what I'm trying to say is if you take the toll money just from the Washington Bridge, you're going to have a heck of a lot more money than you need just to maintain the Washington Bridge.
I understand, but from a federal highway perspective, we're not allowed to. So I want to go to the other piece. With regards to your recommendation, we would increase the gas tax on diesel fuel.
Mm-hmm.
So that affects all businesses in Rhode Island, Joe's Landscape, Mary's Laundry, Jim's bread delivery, Mary, who owns a Volkswagen Jetta that has diesel fuel. That's not fair and equitable from the perspective of the amount of damage they're going to do to the roads, whether it's 1,000 times, 500 times, or whatever. We're going to impact all those folks. Do we want to, that, I mean, that's what you're proposing?
Well, no, I don't want to argue with you, but I'm just saying that my feeling is that, you know, singling out this one industry
okay.
is just not right.
Okay.
You know, I think it should be spread out over everybody that uses it. Now, maybe the truck should pay a little more, but I don't think that it should be they pay it all and we pay nothing when it comes to tolls.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Senator Sosnowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to thank Al for being here in his capacity as speaking for himself as a citizen, and appreciate your comments. And I noticed he has a lot more passion speaking for himself than for the Farm Bureau. But thank you for being here, Al.
All right. And I'll try to find Mr. Salisbury and Ms. Spinella, but I'm not sure where they are.
Thank you very much, Al. Next witness will be Wayne Salisbury, followed by Lynn Spinella, followed by Mark Zachariah, followed by Paul McDonald.
Friendly face. Two friendly faces. When you want me to start, Judge? The
floor is yours.
Anyway, thank you, ladies. And is this thing on?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chairman, for allowing us to take part in this discussion. My name is Wayne Salisbury. I am the Vice President of the Rhode Island Farm Bureau. And we're here in opposition to the toll program that you've spent the last few months listening and talking about. First, let me commend you for having some open minds to various proposals that are being made. From our perspective, and as Farm Bureau members, we are concerned that this is another tax, and let me digress for just a minute to explain. A lot of farmers in this state have products delivered to their place that come in trailer trucks, et cetera, et cetera. Right now, we produce approximately 1% of the food that's sold in the state of Rhode Island. It is an area that many people within the administration, including the governor, have indicated they want to increase. I am not aware of how many. I know a couple of people here are into the farming industry, but I don't know about the rest of you. What I do know is many, many farmers are existing by the skin of their teeth. And if we are forced to pay more for the products we have delivered to Rhode Island, and also the products we ship to various markets and other places, farm markets and consumer markets within the state, it's going to cost our consumers more money. And I'm not sure that that's exactly what we want to do. Believe me when I tell you, I don't really have the answer. But I think, and I will throw my support at this time with the limited knowledge that I have, to Senator Raptakis's program to delay at least 90 days while you get a study committee together to see if you can find somewhere else, to get the funds needed to repair our bridges and our roads. And by the way, we're no different than anybody else here. We all know that bridges and roads need some work. Our dispute is not that they need work, but how we're going to go about financing them. We're also concerned, and I don't know if you realize this enough, and I'm not throwing this out to you because I want you to know, but a number of years back, I was the House Minority Leader. And through all those years, I have never seen a tax that's been imposed on the state of Rhode Island that's gone backwards. Now, you can call this whatever you want, but in effect, it's another burden that somebody has to bear. So I would ask you to use extreme caution before adopting it. I would ask you to take a look at various alternatives that have been proposed and maybe give them a second or third look. And with that, I know you're probably going to be here the rest of the night. I'll shut up and you can go on with your work.
Thank you very much, Rep. Senator Sosnowski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to thank you, Wayne, for being here. Welcome back to the State House. And thank you for bringing us the testimony from the Rhode Island Farm Bureau.
And, you're very welcome.
Good luck. Thank you.
And if I may. Senator Pellegrini.
Mr. Salisbury, I'd like to thank you as my 11th grade accounting teacher for the ability to look at these big numbers.
Yeah,
thank
well,
you.
I appreciate that, Senator. And, you know, it is amazing. I can't take much credit for doing a lot of things right in my career, especially as a teacher. But I look back at it, and there are a whole bunch of people that I taught that are now in the political arena. And quite frankly, I think that's pretty good. At least they're taking part, unlike a lot of people I see in this state that go, well, it's going to happen, the heck with it. So I commend him for running. I'm sure you're all familiar. Mike Marcello was another one of my students, so to speak. And they range from all parties and all lives, but at least they're taking part. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Lynn Spinella.
I'll get her. She's working.